Good evening, everybody. We are at the juncture of data collection and data analysis to our formulation of project, formulation of program, that stage in our Urban Design Studio 8th semester as per the curriculum. So at this juncture, I think this is very necessary that when we process the data, we always come across the strategy to frame up a specific project. And for that, this word, we must have heard many a times from our faculty members. So we thought, this is a very quick notice though, and I'm really thankful to everyone that everybody is participating in this program. So we got him, Mr. Sarkar. And just to brief our complete team of UD, we are almost 9 faculty, including visiting professors and regular faculty member. We have Salila Vanka, we have Kiranmayi Sankavaram, we have Deepak, we have Salini, we have myself is there, Archana is there, we have Dinesh Rao, Professor Dinesh Rao, very senior person. With us, so we have Archana Ramesh and we have Devi Sripal. She's also from SPA. And we have Archana Vichal. Yes, I have mentioned. Yes, Archana is also my student at some point in time in SET. It's a very interesting team. We have new and we have senior people along with us. And 9 of us are divided in 3 sections. I'm in, sort of directly involved with 2 sections, B and C, and constantly we were discussing about this particular term since past couple of sessions. So we got Arvab Sarkar on board for this particular session. He himself says architect. I am calling him urban designer and very versatile person. 15 years plus experience, just 1 year senior than me at our undergrad college at Jadavpur University. But his post-graduation from School of Planning, Delhi, and followed by another post-graduation from AA London. And he has a series of projects where he has worked as urban designer, not only in India. He has almost 5 years plus working in UAE for several international projects. Previous year, we got him for a very short time during the class hours, and this time we are getting him, we are fortunate enough to get him on board for a larger discussion platform. So we will like to hear and learn from his process, the way he actually formulated the structure plan. We quickly jumped into that stage. I request all of us for the time during the presentation, we may keep our audio and video off just to make our presentation completely seamless because of, avoiding any kind of data fluctuation at all. But once we'll finish, I'm expecting that it would be a 40 minutes of lecture, and then we will get 20 minutes to have a very quick interaction with the students. So yes, over to Arnav sir.
Thank you, Vikram. Introduction. Last year, we did a session on structure plan, and then we also interacted with the students for the, I think it was the design exercise also. Now this time I had the same project, but then after discussion, I thought that maybe I'll pull out another project where we can discuss, we can see very clearly how the structure planning process, I'll just in as I talk, process how it is useful. We can go about basically because for me, structure planning is not only applicable to urban design, it is a design tool, design process, and we can use this even for architecture projects and objects for any scale. When you talk about design, we can use this tool, this methodology, this process for designing a lot of stuff across all scales. Now, the benefit of a structure plan that it is a very flexible framework and it keeps evolving based on the changes in brief, site, client, conditions, etc. So it is not directly a plan, like a master plan is a frozen thing or an architectural layout is a frozen thing, but it is a process. So it involves certain steps. Now, for the purpose of this lecture, I documented this and I'll go about these steps one by one. First is a documentation step through which by we do this through mapping. And this is very critical because the better we map the conditions on site, the overall experience that we have based on secondary literature, primary survey, the better database we have and the better it is for the next step, which is the analysis. Now by SWOT, you must have heard this from your teachers, strength, weakness, opportunities, and threat. What we do is after documenting the site conditions, we go through a SWOT analysis. We do it even for architecture, master planning, urban design, everywhere the same process is followed. And then we come up with design strategy. This is the most, the strongest part of the structure planning process, in which the strategies that we come up with, they are based on rational thinking, based on site observations and strong analysis, so backed by analysis. So these strategies somehow look very very much belonging to the site or very appropriate strategies. And based on these strategies, we generally design the brief for the project. It can be at a large urban design scale or it can be at an architecture scale. So this is the scope, the entire, all these activities are possible through the structure planning process. Now I have mentioned again, applicable to all scale of design exercises, and this is a tool to structure any sort of demonstrate one sort. Now there are various components of a structure plan. This is how we build up a structure plan. I will not go into a lot of detail, but I can leave this with you. Maybe the way we build up a structure plan is we look at various layers as we build it up. There can be layers of an urban form, land use, then we talk about urban form, we talk about various elements which Kevin Lin talked about, like edge, path, node, etc. So that's one sort of a thing, which is a morphology. Then we look at mapping the open space, network, community facilities, transportation layers, infrastructure layers, and all these becomes a database, which gives you opportunity to make rational decisions based on your analysis. And this is applicable both at a precinct level and at a master plan level. Now here I'm looking at a sort of a concept structure diagram for four blocks in a city where we can look at land uses. We have the parking strategy. We have various uses, various open space configurations, typologies, all mapped in a single diagram. So this is sort of a, you might say a repository of ideas based on your analysis. This becomes the first step for a design brief. So when you take this up and take each one of, probably a group takes up a block, then it becomes a brief, which you can design individually, but all of it is connected together with a single concept. So when you design and bring your project on the table, all of them merge together into a cohesive master plan, like a cohesive urbanism. So that is the benefit of a structure plan. Now, again, the same thing is applicable at a city level. I'm looking at a structure plan at a city level where I can see a connection, the east-west connection, north-south open space network going onto a waterfront. We can see what are the entry gate locations designated in white circle. Then we have a street, which is the main spine where the main important buildings are. There is a landmark or a node. So all these strategies are mapped on a plan, and when a part is taken up for the exercise, that becomes the brief for that zone. So it's a flexible framework, and it gives you, like it puts all the factors in place in one document, which you can explore in your design exercises. Now I'll take you very quickly through, basically I'll discuss three projects. The first project, I'll just demonstrate the process very quickly. I won't go into much detail. The second and the third project, especially the second project, will give you an idea of how the documentation of various layers takes place. Once you have studied the site, how to document them and come up with a structure plan based on which you can propose a design. So That is the second project. But the first project is to go very quickly through the process. It's like a very short summary of the design process through a structure planning exercise. Now, the project that we'll talk about is this project I did in 2018. This is for Mumbai Railway Vikas Pradhikaran, and wherein we looked at the our suburban railway corridor starting from Panvel to Noida. Panvel is here, Noida, Mumbai, and this is Vikas Railway. Extension of capacity and design TOD applicability and design of four stations. Station
we are losing your voice.
I'll speak a little slowly probably. So, and also tell me when you start losing, I'll give a gap. That will be useful.
Sure.
Okay. So, this is the context of this project. Now, what we did is basically we looked at the site and surroundings based on a lot of data. The site that we have was not identified. I'm showing you the site because this is post-rationalization, post the structure planning process. I'm showing you a finished product. Context. That had a line railway corridor running north-south. We had metro connections in red line here, a metro depot near the site, and we had various infrastructure corridors running through the site. We had Taloja Gao, and we had the Taloja River, which is shown in blue. The site is approximately on railway land, and but its site designation was not yet complete. And this fell in a border zone between two two districts, master planning districts. So there were lots of gaps in the data. And so what we did, we analyzed this, the land use plan. What we did, we see data, this was in this format. So in a lot of these exercises, you would be fortunate to get a very clean data set. The one we started with was very jumbled up. We took it up from different municipalities. We had to develop our own GIS database. We had different sort of layers which were not matching, different development plans. The first exercise is to analyze the raw data, clean it up, and bring everything to the same scale and start superimposing. This is the first step of a structure planning process. Now I'm talking about at an urban level, but the next project, this is to just give you a short overview of the process. The next project is more at a precinct level. There I will go into more detail. Now, once we collate the data from different sources, different agencies, different government bodies, sometimes we have to update it based on site survey. We sort of base it in we did it in CAD and in GIS. And what we started doing immediately after we superimposed the raw data and had a base file is very important. Base file with correct scale and correct roads, etc. We started superimposing the build with the proposed. Now the build we got from the satellite image, and there were various development plans and master plans which gave us the proposed. So what we did, we superimposed the build and the proposed so as to identify the gaps, conflicts, wherever there are broken networks. Because you see, cities are like systems. Roads are a system. Water is a system, and even human network is a system. So we have to look at it from a holistic, systematic, like a systemic point of view. So we superimpose the built and the proposed and come up with this sort of a hybrid, which I call the time-space hybrid, which has the current information, but it also is looking at the future. So this is something which doesn't exist on ground, but which is supposed to happen in a few years' time. So this is some sort of an anticipation of the development which is going to come based on your current information. Like if the current development plan is implemented, if the current projects are completed, and the current conditions on site remain as they are. So this is the anticipated development. Now what this helps us with, it gives us the gaps in the urban structure. Now, what we do in the next step, this is an activated sort of a diagram. Like there are lots of gaps. I have dotted linkages which are missing, linkages start emerging. And that gives us a basis for your structure plan. which is nothing but a completion of the networks. When you superimpose the existing and the proposed, you see the missing links. You see the missing links in terms of open space connectivity, in terms of vehicular network, pedestrian network, and you also see the missing links in terms of city structure. Like you see options for nodes, like I put a recreational road near the river, road again near the river, then opportunity for a landmark on the river, as you pass on the railway, you see the different structures are visible. You have these circles for walkability. So I sort of complete the network. So, and that becomes the framework for the structure plan, the beginning of a structure plan. Now, once I take this structure and start putting in details, that becomes the architectural brief or the development brief. I'll give you a very brief, like a very short glimpse of what happens after this. What do we do after this? Like this is a zoom in of the site. This is not the entire site. This part is the railway station complex. You see my cursor. Visible.
Yeah, you a little lost. Yes.
So I'm saying this is the railway station complex, which we identified. It's always there, but we identified this process, looking at various constraints. Ask the students to look at the, there's a SWOT analysis, opportunities constraint diagram, which becomes the basis of design. The legend. Legend is very important. It gives us opportunity areas, constraints. So identify where the development can take place and what is the nature of the development. So, this is the design. Now, this is the again, yeah.
Voice is, I think, again going up and down. Go a little slow.
Okay. So, yeah, so I'll just. I'll go into the project, probably that will be more interesting for students because here I'm just showing the process. So these are the steps. First, document,
correct.
Then analyze, complete the networks and do a SWOT analysis. The SWOT analysis will give you the start of the design. So that is the, when you go to the next level from the SWOT analysis, you will get the initial structure plan. And based on that, you do your design. This is the process. Let me show you a project of mine. This project I did with my senior, and this was in 2014, and this was a public domain accreditation, urban design proposal for that, for a power plant, which is about roughly about 450 acres, sort of a big project. This was with my senior urban design studio. And the context is that the client wanted to portray a world-class destination. I won't say it's a destination because it's ultimately an industry. What they wanted is basically upgrade their facility, and they have a lot of dignitaries, foreign dignitaries, which because it's a power plant, a lot of foreign dignitaries come and visit their facility. So for them, they want a very good experience and a world-class experience. So it was about designing a new brand image for CEC, that is Kolkata Electric Supply Corporation. And that was a very broad brief. Now, as a project, as a designer, nothing is specified here. We are only given a site, which is quite far from Calcutta, road connectivity. We're asked to look at water connectivity.
I'm interrupting again. Yeah. Would you... If there is a, you know, to adjust, to enhance the voice clarity, if you want, you may put off the video, your video. Yeah.
If this works better. Now,
let's see.
The site was quite complex. And the quality was not great. Obviously, it's not great. That's why they invited us. And this was very complex in terms of the operations of the site, because it's a power plant, active power plant, and we had to design the public domain of the power plant so as to make it attractive. So from the initial brief, we went to the site and we tried to identify what is the industrial flow. And that means what is the process line moving like? They had mainly three ingredients: coal, water, and the output was power, which was on a transmission line at the yard. There was a raw like a lot of ash being generated through the process out from the site and dumped. And railway connection to bring in the raw materials. And we had an active waterfront for the project. So these were the main ingredients, but the most challenging and complex thing was the analysis of the production process itself. So unless we know the production process, we won't know how to bring the dignitaries in and have a dedicated circulation for the industrial production and for public visitor movement. Whereas where they experience the spaces and they don't get to interact with the polluting aspect or the degrading aspect of the industrial production. So these are a few images of the site, and I'll just very quickly take you through the project. It's quite a big site, and it's a lot of green and a lot of water bodies, but unfortunately none of them are used properly. Used, lying vacant, and not also, there is no direct connection to the waterfront, which is a sorry thing to do. Various images of the site. Now, here I would request you to look at the one is the legend, and second is the title. How we sort of presented the data so that for the management, there is clarity in terms of the industrial flow and the visitor flow, so that they can be segregated and the visitor flow and the public domain character can be improved. Now, we look at first the site boundary and the river itself. On it, I'm superimposing the industrial infrastructure, mainly the roads and the railways. And here we noted a lot of these roads were not complete. The network was not complete. So in our analysis, this was one of the important aspects that we need to complete the road network. Otherwise, there are lots of issues with circulation, with functioning, which leads again to lost spaces, issues with security, issues with dumping of a lot of raw materials on site in an unsightly manner, all those things.
Can you please make it full screen, please? Control N.
Is it visible?
Thank you. Yes, wonderful.
Okay, so the next step was to map after mapping the infrastructure, that mapping the factory buildings and the underground and overground infrastructure. Now, these are in sort of boilers, switchgear yards, administrative buildings, and all the infrastructure, the main yards for storing the coal, siding, railway sidings, all those things. Then I superimpose the softer layers, mainly the water bodies and the vegetation layer. Now here you can see that got a large water bodies and there is lot of plantation. Nothing is connected, sort of connected together. All of them are segregated, but they're in good condition. And then we superimpose the overhead infrastructure, and there are huge water pipelines on the site, both overhead and underground. Now these carry process water from between the boilers to these water bodies where they're cooled, and then they're recirculated back like how a air conditioning system operates. So we identified all that infrastructure and in color coded them so that we can segregate and separate them out from the public domain. Like by public domain, I mean the visitor, where the visitors will be visiting and where we can improve the quality of space. Now, when I put them together, this looks like this. But when I analyze layer by layer, this gives me a clarity that there are certain zones which I can segregate out because they are completely industrial zones, and certain zones where the impact of the industries are lesser, and they can be the spaces where the quality of public domain can be improved. Now, looking at a very high level concept, the railway line in red, from which this comes to the central processing plant, it gets segregated. There is part of it goes to dump and part of it goes to the production unit. Production unit, which is the main power plant, the ash goes and gets stored in the ash here. So, typically, the central movement spine of industrial process, and we needed to avoid that very clearly. And also, a very which is in red dotted line here, of a heavy duty industrial infrastructure, which is this zone. Now, based on the site constraints, we did a site constraints and opportunities diagram. Again, this becomes the start of the design exercise. Now, what is in white is all the industrial infrastructure that we wanted to avoid. And what is in green is spaces or the spaces where we can intervene and there is a lesser impact of industrial nature and there is an opportunity to develop. Now, if you look at it in more detail, like I mentioned, look at the legend. Legend becomes very important because site constraints and opportunities are different for all sites. Like the sites that you have in your design exercise will be different from the site I had or the railway site I talked about before. So this particular site has these ingredients. So these legends, legend was different from, this will be different. This is not a standardized legend. Let me put it that way. It changes from project to project depending on the character of the project, this is updated. Now, as a concept, what I can say, and connecting this nature trend, you are connecting. So that was the main concept based on the site constraints and opportunities. In a similar way, what I did before, the same I will repeat. We did the mapping, which was the documentation of the information. We did the analysis, and this is the end of the analysis. And based on this analysis, we'll be doing the design moves, which I'll show you subsequently. Now, when I go to the design proposal, this is the very, very broad level zoning, where we have identified three types of intervention areas within our scope. One is a green, which is open space development, where we can go full throttle and we have lots of opportunities because this is mostly soft development at the moment, except obviously the railway line. The opportunity for a marina on the water. Second layer, which is sort of a medium intervention scope, is this orange layer where we do restructuring and development. There is already some industrial network underneath, and but we at the same time need this because this is a buffer between the softer green spaces and the hard industrial infrastructure which we have to retain, which is shown in magenta. So basically, the magenta is the hard industrial infrastructure which we can screen through landscape. Orange is some sort of a restructuring and development. We don't access them directly, but we sort of look at them from a distance. And we have sort of a green, which you can step in. Maintain the connectivity between the south of the plot and the north of the plot toward the waterfront. We have a sliver of green space, which is sort of an open space development, which is on the axis that we discussed before. Now, looking at structuring the existing vehicular movement, I mentioned before, there is a vehicular network, but it's not, when we come to the front, it is not a complete network, the loops are not complete, both from a public movement and from a circulation of industrial resources, this is incomplete. So based on the analysis, we decided to complete. So what is the additional loop we showed in magenta? So we proposed a road in front so that it becomes a complete loop, and we also loop it to the waterfront, connected this loop to the waterfront. Now the nature of this loop will be decided. It will not be like a hard concrete road, but it can be like a softer Morum road or some sort of a paver situation. But the front road will be so that it can take a load of the fire tender, industrial carriageways, etc. Now this is the step here, we are marking the VIP loops, basically where we want the public to experience the space. Now this is clearly differentiated axis which was here. This axis we cleared up. We had our green intervention areas, green open space along this, and we start this with a landmark and intersect with a landmark and sort of loop around the city so that this, we don't step into the city, but we can enjoy it. I mean, we can look at it in case somebody wants to inspect. This instead of the roadside, we get a completely new opening to the site. But basically, the slide flips over, close the site from the water instead of the road, which is always constrained. So that brings gives us a new scope of work. Now, along the route, we have to design this route in a specific way so that the experience is nicer. There is a boulevard which is proposed. This boulevard is also dotted. It is site constraints. It's dotted. So mapping in the previous layer helps us to identify where we can do the intervention and where we cannot. And you see the network also extends on these arms towards the east and west. That is because we want to give it a character, which is so that it doesn't end in. If you look around, there's still that field. So we found an opportunity to extend this boulevard. Then we sort of proposed demolition plans, wherein anything which is on the axis or visible from the axis, we are demolishing. This is marked out. We are proposing new facades in red, wherein from we are experiencing as we walk new facades, and we are going to develop and treat those facades in a very nice and modern way. Main major facade is this facade of the power plant, which we are going to experience as we approach this main road. So that was a major intervention. All along this were minor interventions. We again highlighted the overhead infrastructure so as to improve their visual quality. At night, we are going to light them up. And like in an examples which you have shared later, there is a disused industrial complex in Ruhr where we took these design cues from, wherein they had converted this into a theme park, and they light these interesting structures at night and basically engaging with them as industrial heritage. And this structure gives us a possibility of opening up different views and vistas. We have a landmark moment here, we have a nodal moment here, and we have different opportunities where we can develop based on these viewpoints. We will develop our landscape interventions. We have an opportunity gateway moment here near the bridge, near the railway line, where we can design sort of a bridge and we can do something on the waterfront. This, I would say, is not really a structure plan, but this is a build up to a structure plan. This gives us a basis to start our intervention because this becomes a brief for the next steps. So this is the third step, wherein we look at different strategies and we freeze them together so that this becomes the start of the design brief. Vikramjit sir, am I audible?
Little bit of fluctuation is happening. I request if you don't use your earphone, then probably it would be better because when we tested, it was seamless.
So.
Yeah. Hello.
I lost you, but basically, I think because I logged in this way, that's why.
Okay.
Can I continue?
Yes.
Okay. So I need to stop here a bit. Because if there are any questions, I can take it up. Because this is the most important steps. Unless we are able to explain this, we will not be making our agenda, we'll fulfill our agenda. So in case there are any questions here, I can stop and answer, or else I can move on.
I think we will take up the question at the end, and then...
Okay.
Dinesh sir, if you want to say something, please.
No, I was just one thing which was a little interesting is that when you're doing the SWOT analysis, do you have a set of criteria on which basis you do the SWOT analysis?
Right. This is the most important question. The criteria comes out of the site. Now, the easiest way to approach it is we put it into some framework. The existing frameworks that are available with us are any urban design framework, for example, Kevin Lynch framework, path, node, character, all those aspects. We can put that in those frameworks. But always, based on the site, we come across different set of parameters which we need to judge. For example, in this one, we looked at the industrial process and we looked at, we gave very big importance to the visual aspect, screening aspect, and wherever there is a pollution, environmental degradation, all those aspects becomes an important aspect of the SWOT analysis. Whereas in the railway thing, connectivity was one of the major important things. We sort of proposed TOD hubs. So how they interface with the residential zones, how the people are moving within the sites, how the existing railway network is operating, where are opportunity areas to develop new projects, those became more important. So based on, there is a set of standard, which is like the preliminary urban design criteria, which we use to design, like the five principles of urban means, but then we need to extend them based on the nature of the project and the site.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay,
thank you
so I will continue. Yeah. Now again, I am looking at the road hierarchy, I will skip this. Now I'm looking at the same principles. I already have the design. Explaining the design through these principles which I laid out. So I have an entry moment. This is the site in axonometric water towards the top right corner, and bottom left corner is the road. Analyzing the design of what I'm able to achieve. So I have an entryway and an entrance gateway structure, land art here. And so I'm looking at the waterfront from here directly as I enter. I have an axis, and at the end of so I have another interesting structure. So I
no, you
like a central
are completely
boulevard.
Not audible.
1 minute. I can change the mic, microphone, and try.
I okay. think so. We can take a pause and please.
Okay, I'll do that. Hello?
Yeah.
Hello? Is it audible?
Yes, better, I guess.
Okay, let us continue. In case there is any problem, then I'll re-log in.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so we have a special vista. We have an axis, a landmark, and from that landmark, we take off a route across the water bodies, have a bridge movement here, and go to the waterfront. Design is not important at this stage. The strategy is more important, so I just want to spend more time on the strategy, because I'm very sure you are all good designers and design, you'll come up with good designs. Now again, I'm looking at the forecourt of this industrial building, where we sort of propose medium interventions. So we can see that with some sort of activated spaces, some sort of, like folly structures, and nothing much. So we don't those spaces, we look at it from other spaces. Central vista and this softer area is more like the activity areas where we dwell in. We have a small sports arena also planned. This part on the left hand side.
Uh-huh.
This is the master plan. So basically, what a problem statement? I analyze the problem statement based on site resources, site constraints. I broke them up into bits. I documented them. I sort of segregated the industrial movement and the guest movement. Very clearly, this is the industrial movement and this is the guest movement. That frozen on plan becomes, or frozen on paper becomes a site plan for me. So I don't have to do anything else. So the one point I want to convey is that if you just follow the process, the design will evolve from the site by itself. We don't have to do anything extra. Now this design I can take to the client, and it will be difficult for the client to argue against it. Now this is one problem which I face always in practice, is that what we propose as designers, it is based on personal judgment. Like if I like something, I design that. So very rarely we come across a process where we base it on rational decision making. So this structure plan approach gives us a way of rational decision making based on site conditions. The central vista, the landmark over the concept. Now there is a difference between concept and context. For the site, I took up a context. I responded to the context. Now for architecture, I am taking a concept. Because power plant, so I took a concept from an electric city bolt, and I took the lighting, and then I site condition. So that there are lots of unsightly structures as I approach. So this is the site gate. So the axis is coming here, so I want to hide. And I want to also look at making a statement through power, because it's a power plant. So what I did, I hid them underground, and I art berm on top, some sort of a soft earth structure, and on which I this had, which is behind other structures which were there, and on top put a like a metal sculpture. It can be different response also. Any response is valid. This becomes my entry moment. So this is a pool builder at the entry level. I won't go into detail. These are some reference visual imagery which we discussed. Now I'm talking different themes of ideas, and we took up a theme. Let me go to the next one. This is the iconic gateway we talked about. There's one of the responses. And this is great, but just to have an art structure so as to hide whatever was behind this with a perforated insert, and did not completely agree to the idea of art structure, so we had to have some security provisions also. Like the green foreground to the development, where we sort of a mound. This was another concept wherein we light up the structures, the industrial structures on top, and basically we focus on them, and this becomes sort of a theme. And these lines sort of evolve from that because of a particular nature. Straight lines, generally in landscape, we prefer curved lines, but straight lines we took up because it was an industrial project and it reminds us of the industrial process. This is a switchgear here. These are some concepts around buildings, the facade treatment that we wanted to do. Yeah. Some reference images. So I'll browse through this because design was not the main objective here for this, because yeah. We had late presentations done at a later stage also, but the process will not be there. So I took up this report.
Yeah.
This is the central vista where we focused. Not bothered by the industrial. This is like one of the schemes as we go to the waterfront. Showing some sketches which were done on the waterfront. This is the waterfront zone. We had a nice reed bed there because the water was polluted, so reeds grew, and we sort of thought of expanding on the reed beds. Like a wetland park. Some amphitheaters to activate those spaces. This is a reference image for landmark structure at the end of the vista. Recreational areas, pathways, and this is the overall theme. Basically, what we did, we flipped the project over. So instead of approaching and experiencing the project from the road, we thought it might be useful looking at the site conditions to approach the project and experience the project from the waterfront. So when a person approaches, right here, and take this room through this green development and enter the main building. So he won't have to bother with this approach. Now here.
Yeah, I suggest be fluctuating.
I'll stop share and
yeah, please. You just hold for a moment. Sorry for the inconvenience. I think these days these are the issues we often face. We have to bear with this. Meanwhile, for the students, we may take maybe three questions. So maybe each section can come up for one question. I think that is sufficient for the evening. Benefit also. Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes.
So here I'll present one project which we discussed last year. This one is because it has a very clear structure plan. In the previous example, is my screen visible?
Yes. Please full screen.
The last presentation was more like a process. Okay, the process I wanted to illustrate, and the various steps were shown there, whereas it didn't have a clear structure plan, what we call a structure plan. This project has a structure plan, but the process here is not visible because that was internalized. The clients generally don't care much about the structure plan. That was an industrial project. And since it was very complicated and it was very important for us to show the thought process and why we chose those restricted areas, that was very important. That's why we sort of demonstrated the stairs. This is a project which I did in Abu Dhabi when I, this is Mina Zayed. Mina means port, Zayed is Sheikh Zayed, who is the founder of UAE. So this is port, which is dedicated to him. This is in Abu Dhabi and I'll introduce the site. The project is based on Abu Dhabi 2030 vision, wherein we looked at these various parameters of connectivity, identity, and opportunity, looked at creating an unique environment and an evolving culture. This becomes very important because we are looking at a knowledge economy. We are transforming the port into the next level of development based on knowledge and creative resources. So that was part of the brief. So an evolving culture, excellence and livability, livable city concept, walkability, all those sort of desired qualities of space, and sustainability, which is an overarching vision. Now, this is a precinct map. The project is located here. This is the Gulf, basically. And these are the various districts of the city. We for ourselves defined four criteria where we were based on the client brief, which is apart and in addition to the city brief, city design. We looked at culture and heritage because the site had a history of fishing and pearl diving. UAE in general was based on fishing and pearl diving, trading. There was a port there. A part of the port is still active. There is both a military port, yacht marina, and a port which is partially disused. So all these three functions are existing. This is a unique location because this is the Arabian Gulf, not the Persian Gulf. This is the farthest point in the Arabian Gulf, almost 2 kilometers into the waterfront. Almost 20 kilometers off waterfront is available. That is when we measure the perimeter of the site. We have a trading history because this is a port and a trading hub. There was a big fish market there. And there are lots of warehouses and nurseries there. And there is a maritime history which we wanted to celebrate, which I've already talked about. I won't go into too much detail into this background, but otherwise this will make it boring. I will come to the point because we need to discuss the structure plan rather than the project. Vikram, is the voice clear at this time?
It is clearer. I think one student has suggested that move your cursor. If you reduce your movement of cursor, then probably it would be a better.
Sometimes exactly. This is what I experienced last year also. When I started annotating on screen, voice was not audible. Last year.
Yeah. I think. Thanks. Harshita is mentioned. Thanks.
Okay. Celebrating. Let it be. Based on culture and heritage. It's a strategic location because it's a maritime base. And also this projects into the water, it has great visibility from the all around, both to look into the site and look out of the site. There is generally a US Marine installation here also. We need to future-proof through education, innovation and creation, basically creative district concept, innovation district, that was our main part of the brief. And have sustainable communities. And having a yacht terminal, cruise terminal, basically to theme it in such a way so that it becomes a destination for the city and also for the world, because the people will be visiting this place as a part of a cruise network. This is one of the terminals of the cruise network. So it is showcasing to the world also. Looking at the site in terms of transport connectivity, this is a future proposed metro. The site is here, and this is waterfront, and this is the site, and the orange is the metro and the metro connectivity. There is a metro terminal proposed here, the orange line which you see going inside the site. There is a depot, metro terminal, and along with that, a TOD hub is proposed there. Because the LRT, MRT, and the transport road networks intersect in that zone. And that is also the beginning of the port area. So that becomes a good location for a TOD hub. This is the water taxi proposal. Part of it is operational, part of it is proposed. And water taxi basically connects all the islands together, because Abu Dhabi as such is a connection of collection of islands. And one of the proposals is to connect all of them through a water taxi and design a, and there is a mangrove there, natural mangrove there, connect the water taxi through kayaking through the mangrove. So it becomes a tourist experience. Okay, the existing site condition. These are the, there is an island which is towards the left, and that is, we need to connect that to this island. We have a TOD hub here, the port operations are here. There's a cruise terminal here. There are warehouses here. Here.
Yeah.
And okay, so I'm again documenting. Okay, the first step I'm documenting, I'm superimposing all the transportation layers and the hard infrastructure layers on the map, the black which is one of the main connector. The blue lines are sort of the water taxi routes. This is an existing route which you wanted to retain because this connected the water side. The Cornish, which is in blue, green dotted line here on the water. And we look at the metro depot, the TOD hub, existing grid, which is in light, the thin blue line. Now, this is an opportunity and constraint diagram, and you will notice this opportunity and constraint diagram is different from the previous two, and it is also at a different level. In the sense, in the earlier one, we had minor fine grains. Here we have more coarse grains, and we are talking in terms of districts and big connectivity, sort of bolder moves, bigger moves. Like if I look at the legend here, creative district node, potential recreational node, potential transport node, so each of them will be quite big. So each of them, probably the hatched, yellow hatch in the center with the entire project, which has a different scale and different sort of, and we generally map nodes, district landmarks, path edges, etc. We also mark views, so here what we have is a peripheral blue line, which is so in high value real estate where you have great visibility shown by the arrows. We have some sort of an inner district, yellow hatch, which is sort of a low value land where we need to create something, which is a constraint, but we need to create something because otherwise this will not have real estate value. So we thought of creating the creative district there. The other part of the land, which is on the periphery, already has real estate value. We don't need to create anything. Here we need to create in the internal part. There is a TOD hub, transport interchanges meet. There is a cruise terminal which you have to retain connected with the other hubs. There is a green spine. There is another development proposed on the north. And connecting that to our district. I'll show you in more detail when I talk about the plan. And then again on this side, I'm connecting back to the island. This island is a recreational island. So I'm connecting back my island, this particular, this sort of an isthmus to this island. So all these are the connectivities and the opportunities and constraints. Landmark opportunities here, a landmark opportunity here. Sadiat Island, this is called Sadiat Island. Janu will design this Louvre Museum, which is directly on bank opposite side. So these people will have a view of that museum here. Which is already there. So I'm trying to design closed loops, and I'm trying to identify location where I can enter these grids. So basically, the connect those existing road networks disturb in a very transport driven line. That is a very transport dominated grid. I'm not heavy transportation is sort of restricted to the periphery where the red and blue line. He wanted to retain the fisherman's wharf, which is towards the south of the site, and have some major cultural landmarks on this yellow dotted. At the city also. It's a great skyline. So we are sort of developing the client's brief, and we have a framework out of that road network, out of those constraint opportunities, and we look at some sort of a beginning of a structure plan. So this is an in-between stage between a structure plan and a conventional master plan, like an illustrative master plan. This stage is important because it gives us, this is a like a more frozen master structure plan, I would say. It is a structure plan, but it sort of freezes the responses based on scale, uses. What we have out of this are, we already defined these plazas, we define the important edge conditions where we have want to have important buildings. We sort of define the open space network. It is flexible, but it some sort of forms a logic, and we start to define the grid. We look at working on the north-south, east-west axis, and sort of express those in terms of opportunities for any like landmark moments. So this is an in-between stage of a structure plan and an illustrative master plan. And then we start to identify different buildings and developments within that framework. Like these are the primary urban design gestures, primary sort of design moves. The central yellow bit, the dot, is more like a plaza, big urban plaza. And the one and two will be more like covered plaza, so that there is a covered street connecting north and south, where we can filter the solar radiation, rays, harsh weather, etc. Now building onto that, we have primary nodes and then secondary nodes based on a 300 meter walking radius. So we'll have the minor nodes on these locations. And then we look at the access layer. Access layer again starts from the structure. We have the red line, which is the metro connectivity and the central boulevard. And from there, we take in these tapping points. And one of the tapping points goes into the main plaza. And so we sort of disperse from that plaza. The pedestrian sort of disperses from that plaza. And you'll see that we had small, thin pedestrian routes, which sort of started from this plaza. And we sort of, based on, I mean, the strategies from start from this structure. So that we freeze that in terms of master plan, illustrative master plan. We have the public transport network route, the main stations, and the major interchanges. We also have the water taxi routes. Water taxi takes into consideration all the landmarks that we have designed, and also the basically the cruise terminal, the Louvre Museum on the other island, and also a little bit inland, goes into Almaria Island and connects to the overall like the kayaking route.
Yeah.
This is zooming into the development. We sort of freeze the road networks into different hierarchy system. We have a central retail street detailing out the central access. We sort of look at the grade of retail, like grade, I mean, whatever grade means, like high quality, low quality, big footprint, small footprint, high street, regional retail load, sort of make those distinctions. We have an artisan district and we have a theater district based on the brief that we had defined for ourselves in the structure plan. This is a view of the retail street near the plaza. This is Festival Square, the main plaza. We had some sort of the original location of the creative district. Now, based on the structure, we sort of shifted and we had the added layer of the green movement, the pedestrian movement through a green open space network superimposed on this. And you will see all this is actually following the logic of the original structure plan. Whatever we gave for ourselves, created for ourselves in the original structure, we are just following that here. And that original structure becomes a brief for the architects. Whenever we take up one precinct, for example, we take up this precinct. So there is a retail district here where there are punctures here where we enter the site. We have a green spine which is going like this, a central green plaza, and all around we have a road. So that becomes a brief for the architects. We have an industry, we have a college and a design institute zone on the basically the metro, wherever we have good connectivity, developing. And then another concept in which we are decentralizing the basically institutional zone and putting it within the residential fabric. We look at a Soho sort of a situation, which is a creative destination, a lot of retail, entertainment, a lot of activities going on, people meeting each other, cultural destinations, all those sort of activated public spaces. And we line it all up on the waterfront with high value real estate so that we don't lose the potential of the waterfront. So there'll be more high rise development and we'll have open spaces puncturing these high rise developments so that we don't lose the visual porosity. And then we have a more mixed use standard zone in the interior part where we have a transit based development, more high density sort of a development here. Walkable, high density, but walkable. And we have a proposal for the cruise, locating the cruise terminal, connecting it with the cultural facilities which we have created for ourselves so that we maintain a spine, activity spine. Landmark opportunities at the edges of the spines. We have a big park on the southern side where the fisherman's port, this is the fisherman's port, fisherman's market, but we have a park here to overlook that. Celebrating the cultural landmark that we created there. This is a fisherman's wharf. The architectural concept also we did later on. And this is sort of a summation of it all together, overall land use, and then the larger level mean part was done by somebody else. This is the open space network back to us. At the larger level, this should work. So that is the idea. First we document, then we analyze. After the analysis, we look at design iterations. That becomes very easy because we are looking at a thematic level, at a sketch level, instead of going into a diagram like a CAD and a hard drawing and changing everything if there is negative comment. We just make these diagrams which are very, I'll go back to the diagram, very flexible sort of high level diagram which can be done in a day to ideate, basically give design concepts, design ideas, and discuss various design options. So based on the selected options or a mix of multiple options, we can have a design brief, which then goes on to the next level. So that is my understanding, I would say, of a structure plan.
Yeah. So I think this is truly a eye-opening session for the students and for all of us. Can we go for a question of the session?
Let me go back to this one, the initial PowerPoint slide I did. I think that is important because which are going to change from time to time. These are the principles. Probably we can discuss these principles.
So I would request students, if you can come up and resolve your queries, put up your queries and try to get particular view from him. Section C, Section B, Section A.
Okay, let me put a context to this, because otherwise looking at two arbitrary projects from very different contexts might not be useful for students. What I wanted to create for students is a way of approaching a site. Now, the process that I followed for these two sites, in fact, the first in this step, in this one, I showed you what is the process to extract information out of a site. When we have a jumble sort of layer, we go into different layers. We identify the important components and we try to complete those networks. That is all that you have to do in your chosen site.
Yeah.
So if you have your site with you, you already know your site very well. You have to analyze the site based on a certain framework, and based on the framework, you will see there are certain gaps within your site. So that those gaps, when you address through design, becomes your structure plan.
Yeah, Togo, maybe you can put on the camera now.
Okay.
Hello, sir. This is Vaishnavi.
Yes, Vaishnavi, please.
Sir, like I wanted to ask you, all this information that you layered, did you like what were the sources for that? Like, did you get it from the client itself, from the brief, or did you have to go approach the government agencies for information?
Yes, so it is both ways. Whenever we are looking at a project, see, your project and my project would be different. I will first answer my project, then I'll come to your project. In my project, generally, if I look at the UAE context, I don't have any challenge because everything is in GIS and whatever information I ask for is already available. It is for me to ask what I want.
Yeah.
So all the building uses are there, the road transportation layer is there, all the road is designated, each road has a particular capacity associated with it. There is no gap in the information. If there is a gap, and we can address it. Coming to the Indian context, the situation is not that good. What the client generally gives us is what he has with him, and often he doesn't know what to give. Because in most cases, these projects are taken up across municipalities, and you will see in some cases there are conflicts between municipalities. In some cases, there are no centralized authority which is coordinating this project. In our case, we were fortunate, we had an authority. So they collated the information and gave them to us. But when we analyzed, we saw there are huge data gaps. One DP, and in the border zones especially, in this particular case, this was a border zone. The data set in from one municipality doesn't match the data set from another municipality. We'll see that there are gaps. What is certain things had been built, whereas in the master plan, some other things are there. So we have to query and get additional information from the site. In some cases, it is available. In some cases, in most cases, it is not available. In that case, we can procure it from secondary sources, being GIS. But in case we don't have budget and scope, we have to go with Google Earth Map. That is the most reliable thing because that is already built on site. And to top up the Google Earth Map is a site survey, which we should always do. So these are the processes available with us to basically bridge the information gap. To answer your question in short, first part is we have information with us available, but that information is seldom complete in our context. So we have to go back to the municipality. And it is always good to have, before you start the project, to identify, looking at the scope of work for the project, which the developer or the government agency will give you, come up with a sort of an inventory of data that you require to address that scope. That is the easy, I mean, to start from the beginning of the project, you'll be able to kill this issue. What happens if you request the project now, request the data now, you'll get the data after 2 months. By that time, you're already past the concept stage. So data is not useful or the concept becomes redundant after you get the data. That also might happen. So basically is to write the brief properly and get the data, ask for the data, looking at the brief and scope. Now, this first part of the answer. In your context, you will probably, most probably have a site. In our case, we did not have a site. We have to identify the site based on the exercise. So this, once you have the site, how the problem is done, because you know the owner whom to approach for the information. So he will give you the information. He might not have some person or your permission, like bylaws, etc. If you have architectural project, this is the way to approach. If you have a community project, you have to go to the community, look at various activity patterns. I think that will be taken up in some classes wherein we do urban design studios, and there is a methodology for getting information.
Okay. Sir, one more question I had. I mean, this might seem like a very naive question, but other than scale of the project, what would be like the fundamental difference between an urban project and an architectural project?
The architectural project is bounded by a boundary wall. Generally, there is a size limitation is there, but that is not always relevant. In a public domain project is what I might say an urban design project, is something which is going beyond one single client and which is engaging the community. It can be a small project. It can be a neighborhood road also, like connecting project, an urban level project, but the stakeholders change. In your architecture project, there is only one stakeholder. Here, there are multiple stakeholders, different issues which are beyond the site, and you have to address those issues. And in those cases, having a rigorous process helps. It helps in negotiation and discussion. If I go with arbitrary architectural approach for an urban design project, nothing will proceed, because the stakeholders will say, I don't like this. But if you are able to put forward a process which I demonstrated in the power plant project, there is no arguing against that, because this is the fact which is emerging from the site. So I think short answer, the process is different, client is different, and concerns are different. Size generally becomes an issue, but that is not the criteria.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
If you want, I can give you feedback on your site also.
Yeah, if somebody is ready with specifically B and C, I requested earlier, if anyone has the site ready, if they can project, then we can have a very quick discussion. Manoj? Neat. No.
Tell me something like, was this useful to the students?
I am asking. Let them answer.
Like if somebody from randomly shows you these two presentations, what would you understand?
Let's not hesitate, please. Come forward.
These are like basically design sessions, and you are fortunate because we can discuss. I'm also fortunate, I can discuss. But what I'm saying that generally these sort of interactions don't happen if you're in a physical world, and we are not able to explore. We'll just go with whatever is available locally. We can now approach different people sitting in different places, gain different experiences, get different context.
Sanjay, you have anything to ask? Sujan?
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, yeah, please go ahead.
The mapping part, because as sir said, if someone randomly shows the mapping, I feel like I would be able to understand, because all these layers were so precise and overlapped really well. But coming to I had a doubt in the design part. Sir, could you go to the one you did in Dubai? The plan?
Yeah. This one? I have to project.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you need to change this. Okay.
So I think you mentioned the central like of that area of the residential being highly dense with the idea of walkability, right?
The central spine.
One second, I'll just try drawing it.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Continue.
It was this area, right? Somewhere. Around which was
okay. Sorry, I already moved out, but you can show it here.
This area, this one being highly, I want to know. It's interesting to see how you used like this another urban example and incorporated here, but why did you stick to these linear and grid patterns, especially like with the ideas of walkability? Because we studied something in urban design called serial vision, and you know, that was something which was, I think, like, you know, not here, but this also looks very interesting. So why did you choose that grid pattern even
in
for
this case, what we decided, it was it was there in one of the slides, I didn't mention it. We sort of decided to keep the grid as much as possible and use the infrastructure as much as possible. We didn't want to disturb this grid because we thought that this grid is not a problem. What is a problem is the grid size and the open space network. So what we did, we smoothened this grid with the open space network. This grid is still I understand serial vision. Serial vision, we are trying to attempt through these nodes, series of nodes we see from one place to others that we are trying to address. But let me go back to the sketch once I can go back here. So we have a break in that, but that was through the open space. We retained the grid there as a sort of a gesture. I didn't want to disturb too much. I agree with your question. I might have done a different grid also. Important was the grid size here. But the question is, why would I do a different grid? That question is, again, I would have asked myself. So in this case, I just retained the grid. This was already an existing road network. I retained the grid. I rationalized the grid so that these grids become more walkable instead of car dominated. For example, this grid, this is an architecture project.
Okay.
So I have this 100 by 100 block. This is roughly 100. You see here 100.
Yes.
100 block. I can have a podium structure. I can put four towers. This is a very favorable typology in that zone. And I have a central green, and I have an open space network, and I have road access on three sides. I can still operate out the road. For example, same exercise has been done in Barcelona, where they had taken out it's an experiment, where they had taken out the roads in between and created within that orthogonal grid and open space connectivity. So that is what we attempted. I didn't mention that because then if you change everything, it becomes a brownfield. This is not a brownfield, this is a greenfield in which if we can address and work with those existing infrastructure, I think we actually do more instead of looking at something which is more visually interesting. I think this functionally works. We achieve our objective, but at the same time, we are able to introduce a little bit of pedestrianization within those clusters also. That was one of the objectives. Okay, we could have done it in a different way, but this was the approach that we took. It was guided by existing grid and sustainability, doing minimum and still achieving the objective.
Okay.
I'll give you another example. This is because it is the architectural discussion. So I'll give you another. Look at the central spine. Yeah, okay. Oh. This is where the public transport is. So public transport is here. We have a road parallel to this. What happens, vehicular access on these blocks from this side. The vehicular access is on this side. So what happens in a boulevard? Let me show you the picture. Boulevards, generally, if there are too many median cuts and if they're small projects, what happens? This
No, not audible, much.
Huh?
Go a little slow.
Yeah. There are too many punctures on the road. And then it is very difficult with a front drop-off situation to have a boulevard. what we did, we introduced which made those buildings in the front be able to have this sort of a public domain in front, and this road becomes a boulevard. So we, this, I mean, this is not only a diagram, the strategies are inbuilt, the grid size strategies are inbuilt into this diagram. Now, what we could have done, we could have made this grid a little thinner. We have a 5-meter block instead of a 100-meter block, which is thinner, but we could have done, maybe we'll do it in the next iteration. When we are doing the illustrative plan, then we'll do this move. But the intent is there.
Okay. Yeah, I think it makes sense now that you've spoken about it, that, you know, following that grid and we perceive the serial vision in a different way. Yeah, that was my question. So that's all.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Sir, like last question, I just wanted so vision is a very important element that designers consider, but like apart from that, like other than pedestrian movement, everything is on the map, right? Like what else, what other like do you consider other factors, like other senses and, you know, other psychological factors or something like that? Because that is often, I've seen that takes a back seat in terms of urban design.
Well, they are there, definitely there. Urban design has a role to play in that. Especially, I will give you a very concrete example. There is rather diffused topic, but I'll give you a concrete example. If you go in your city, if you go to the city core, the old city, and you look at the street there, I mean, it's respectable, not like a very bad quality street. You look at the street section, you look at the enclosure condition, you look at the height versus width of the street, and you will see that is a cozy section based on human scale. You go out again to the highway, look at the highway section, look at the street condition, look at the width of the highway versus the facade on the side. You probably won't see the facade, and look at your mental state if you're walking on a highway versus you're walking on the street. It is directly connected with the sense of security. It is directly connected with the enclosure quality, which is again connected with urban design. It has nothing to do with visual quality. It has nothing to do with the quality of the facade. It is entirely to do with how the volumes have been disposed on space. This is very important in urban design. So how you put your volumes in space makes your space, and that defines your space. So that is very important. I mean, this is there. I'm talking about urban design. You can have the same example in other, like in landscape also. For example, I went to this place called Parc de la Ville. It is designed by a modern architect, Bernard Schumi. And there are weak spaces. It was like a boucherie before. It was in the periphery of the city. He got a lot of space and he did a lot of interesting things. Architecturally, this is very interesting. But if you look at the space, quality of space and the activation of space, I don't think it is very well activated. And that is again directly connected to the enclosure quality. The same city has Garden of Versailles. You have to go out a little bit. The sense of space there is much better. The feeling of space, because of the tree-lined avenues, the section that is created by trees, not only by buildings, by trees, is more intimate, and you feel a sense of security, and that is more popular to the visitors. So it has a lot to do with the enclosure quality and the volumes that you design.
Like I saw your projects, they are really amazing. Thank you for showing. So one doubt what I had was, since we can't go on the site, and this is the urban planning subject where we have to be on the site and we have to look out all the like all the features and all the aspects of like in for you know urban planning. So since
urban
we
design.
Can't go, sorry, urban design, sorry, sir. So since we can't be on the site, and how can you like give us some tips? Because you are like your projects, you had to be on site and you had to see all the aspects. So is there any tip for us since we can't be on site and study all the aspects?
Yeah, this is a big challenge. Even when we are guiding Vikramjit, when we are guiding this last year Jamia students, the same issues were there because of certain like.
Correct. We have adopted one technique, and it was in a way, you know, it is an experiment for all of us, for the students and for us also. One group has come up with a very interesting existing site model based on the images and movies, films, or small clips, video clips available over internet. So one particular site, they are just replicating the site as what it is existed at present. Well, I understand that it is not 100% authentic, but at least 70 to 80% they have tried to achieve, which is a good task, I think, that probably recreate the situation in front of our eyes so that we can now start analyzing things. So this is one technique which one group has done and really appreciated, and they are still adding the data to the model, to the main model, and I think very soon they will come up with a much detailed sort of understanding. Yeah. So this is one thing which I may suggest. Yeah. I don't know, sir. You may. Yes, it is a similar problem everywhere. I remember that. Some of my early colleagues from Ahmedabad, they were also sharing the similar situation. And
this is definitely a
big challenge.
Big issue. There is no direct solution. This is a good approach. I mean, what we can do is for a few months or few, like one or two sessions, where we can choose sites where there is a lot of information available. Instead of choosing like really difficult sites, good project, but no information, it is better to go with some explored sites, especially thesis, because thesis people will need that information. They won't be able to do everything based on secondary sources. And this is a valid question. Definitely. There is I don't think any other approach is there.
Yeah. I think Soumya, your group is also in the process of developing model, and we will try to, you know, sort of help you out to make it more, you know, close to the reality, not the reality.
I got an idea. Basically, satellite image we start from. If somebody can get a drone, you can use a drone also to get good images from top.
Difficult, but Karupaya, yes. Would you like to say something?
Yes, sir. Can you show a group of like we have something
like
that? Sir, can we show a group work, sir? Like we have some doubt on it.
Very quickly.
Yes.
Can you please stop your sharing screen, sir? Arnab, sir? Yeah. Correct. Yes, Parupaya.
I think one interesting experiment which we can do this particular year is we can work on areas which are close by, so that each group can share and use each other's model, so that the overall effort is reduced. Maybe.
Yeah, we have tried to do that only. So that yes, Karupaya, please ask the specific question quickly. We will end it. We have already
just
our time. Yes, please.
Yeah. So, sir,
can't hear you, Baba.
Yes. You have to unmute, Beta. No, we can't hear. You have to unmute, Beta. Unmute yourself, please.
Rupaya, are you trying to talk?
Excuse
me, sir.
Yes.
Meanwhile, could I ask a question?
Yes, Rushti. Yes, please.
Sir, in your previous presentation, when you talked about pedestrianization, you know, I mean, what are the other challenges and how do you address them?
Between there is this this thing, whether you provide vehicular access happen on top of the podium also, so all those within the site are addressed, but as a vehicular public connection we cut off parts of the road, so there is a trade-off between vehicular access and pedestrian access. We have pedestrian access but cut off on the vehicular access by like in putting it in a different way, by looking at the typology, by changing the typology of the building, changing the plot size. Now, if I have instead of a 100 by 100 plot, generally suppose in India we are doing 30 by 50 plot, for example, or even smaller. Instead of that, I am doing a bigger plot. So my parking is combined, efficiencies are better, and the road network required is lesser. If I go for a bigger plot, then it reduces like exponentially after that. So that is the trick, I think. Typologically, it has to change. We can't have the same building type in which everybody requires an access and still have this level of pedestrianization. What we need is the building, car enters the building, the parking levels are connected, and then the road is minimized. Because this, if you enter the building once, you don't need the road on the other sides. That is the main, I think, trade-off. I think that Barcelona study is very well done. You can look at it. It is quite useful. I can give you one building typology. There is a project called The Greens, Greens in Dubai, The Greens. Study that typology. You'll see that even bigger plots, big densities are possible with minimum roads layout.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Karupaya, please unmute yourself. No, I think it is a problem. So we will not able to take any more question. I think we have to end. Really, really great for your time. I would like to request Dinesh sir, would you like to say a few words?
Just a moment. Yeah. I think it was very, very nice and very, very simply explained. I think the beauty of the process was, I think you highlighted that very well. And the fact that same process can be applied for different kinds of projects, I think that is the strength of it. And I'm sure it will help the students to actually see that how a process can actually, you know, assist you in formulating a brief, because I think that is the challenge which they are facing. How do you formulate a brief? And like you said, this gives you a very sound logical sequence of argument, which is not so easy to refute. So it puts you in a very strong position to defend your brief.
Right, sir, right. That is the important thing, I think.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Dinesh sir. Salira ma'am, would you like to say a few words?
Thanks again. It was a wonderful talk, and as Dinesh also said, it's a very lucid and well presented talk, and very timely. So thanks to Vikramjit as well, because our students currently are working on the structure plans, and it couldn't have been better timing. Thank you very much, and thanks for your patience with their questions as well. So,
thank you for joining us, for yes. I think I was behind him for quite a long time, but somehow yesterday it got clicked. And he also, because he took vaccination, he did vaccination yesterday, so he is taking rest.
How are you doing? I don't have any
all good, no problem as yet, all fine.
I think the first 24 hours are the most crucial, so I guess
you're fast. So I said that you can't take rest, please work for me. And I have that kind of relation with him, yeah. So thank you all. I think our other faculty members who have joined, Prashna sir, Seema ma'am, and our studio team, everybody, Archana Ramesh, Salila, Devishri, everybody was here, and really good to have all of you together. And we'll finish it here, and I hope that in coming submission, for all of us, from all of you. Okay, thank you, Arnab sir.
Thank you, thank you.
Hope we will see. You.
Okay, I look forward to it.
Yes, good. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome back. So parallelly, good job.